You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. Be optimistic.
Composition of the golden, enrolled in school of life, through the dice, through it like
I was on the prize.
Living in ambition on a mission impossible, envision optimism through a prism that's optical, to see through obstacles and be remarkable.
I was on the prize.
Living it for the infinite, intuit of the intimate, influenced by the sentiment, sent to it to winning it, surrendered it to the sky, centered in my eye.
I was on the prize.
Living in the glory and the story of a warrior, Victoria, the more we love. From how poor we was to euphoria, kicking the door because we think notorious.
Welcome to Understanding Principles for Better Living's online church service. We want you to praise the Lord right where you are. Come on, let's have some fun. Sing along with me if you will. I know you know this one.
Ain't no stopping us now.
Worship team, thank you for the gift of your talent. All right, understanding principles, let us pray. Father, Mother God, we open our hearts and our minds to your teaching. We recognize that there is only one power, there is only one presence. That power, that presence is you, the everywhere, evenly present spirit of absolute good. No matter where we are, no matter what we may be feeling, no matter what we may be going through, you are the only power and presence there is. And so we give our full attention to this energy intelligence, this infinite knower that knows everything there is to know. Father, Mother God, we sit at a time of so much uncertainty, so much confusion. So many things have been upended in our experience, and we just need a word. And so what I ask is that this service be that word for a people who need to know that you are in the midst of this entire thing. Not only are you in the midst, but you're the only presence and power there is. There is no second operating power. And so we ask that this message of universal oneness, this message of divine unity, go out across the planet and be an agent for good. We ask that this message of divine humanhood spread out like a rolling sea, touching hearts and minds, dripping on the negative energy and dissolving it back into the nothingness from whence it has come. May the work that we do here have an unending ripple effect in the river of humanity. May what seems to be a drop by a small community in one little corner of the world send out waves of love that transform this planet. Let the songs that we sing shift us. Let the words that we speak shift us. Let the testimonies that come through shift us. May we be changed at depth. May we awaken a spirit of loving kindness for ourselves and for our fellow humans. May we awaken a spirit of awareness that we are in this thing together, that we are all we got. And so we must love each other through our difficulties, love each other through our differences, love each other through our varying ideologies, love one another. Let the message of love go forth from this platform. Let us be a conduit. As you download love, we send it out. Download love, we send it out. Download love, we send it out. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And I know that sounds like a tall order for a 1 hour service, God, but hey, you big. You bigger than anything there is. You're all there is. You are absolute. And so I can stand in the assurance that this prayer is answered. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And so it is. And amen. Are you ready to be changed? Are you ready to be changed? I don't know if I believe you. If you are really, 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 really ready to be changed, put it in the chat. Put it in the chat. Put it in the chat. And say, Rev, I'm ready to be transformed. Or Rev, I'm ready to be changed at death. Or if you really mean it, say, Rev, I'm ready to break every chain. Good afternoon. I am Reverend Sheree James. I am the senior minister of this amazing community of spiritual seekers. And I am so excited to be with you this afternoon, because what I know is that if you are here, however you got here, if you are here, you are here because your soul knows that what you have demonstrated thus far isn't even the half of what's possible. And you are ready. Your soul is calling for a deeper expression of who you are. And I want to tell you, you are in the right place at the right time for the right message. So pat yourself on the back. You are here, baby. Now, we have a vision for this spiritual community. And our vision is to love every person up to their true identity and to their highest potential for the greater good of all. We are on a mission to express God's divine love through teaching spiritual principles, worship services, fellowship activities, and community outreach. Our theme this year is Break Every Chain. And we are in a new series that is called Spiritual Solutions for a Human Crisis. We know that this is a moment, this is a sea change in your life and my life. And so what we want to give you are the spiritual solutions that last for all eternity. Whether you live in 1918, 2018, 2028, or 1214, wherever you find yourself, what we are offering you in this series is going to last you for all eternity. And so buckle up and get ready. Now, our assistant minister, Reverend Sheree Thompson, is going to be bringing the message. We are working from the text, Hidden Power for Human Problems. And so I just invite you to just sit back and relax and just get ready for something amazing. And to prepare ourselves, we're going to take a moment and get quiet, because we want to set up that spirit of expectancy. And so what I'm going to do next is walk you through a really brief guided meditation, and then we're going to set the party off. All right, family, let's go. This is our opportunity to get quiet. This is our opportunity to set up a spirit of expectation. And so the first step is just simply to get quiet, simply to relax. So wherever you carry your tension, just speak to it. Peace, be still. Peace, be still. We're going to put an image on the screen that you can rest your eyes on, or you can simply close your eyes, whatever feels comfortable. But just continue to speak to your body. Peace, be still. Peace, be still. If there are any thoughts that try to reach for your attention, you can just simply speak to them. This is God's time now. Peace, be still. Peace, be still. And now focus on the breath. And you don't want to alter it in any way. We just want to pay attention to the out-breath. Notice when the breath moves back across the nose out into the world. And in this calm spirit, you want to bring to mind something that brings you deep gratitude. Perhaps you're grateful just to be alive. Or maybe you're grateful for the safety of your family. Maybe you're grateful that you're giving yourself this gift of getting quiet. Or maybe you're grateful for something that you didn't think you would make it through, and you did. And just let that feeling of gratitude fill your heart and just wash over you completely. Thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. Maybe a smile plays across your lips, just for the deep gratitude for all that you have been given. And as we bring this short meditation to a close, we just give thanks. We know with that simple exercise, we have opened a window of expectancy in our hearts. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And so it is.
Thank you so much, Reverend Sherri, for that beautiful meditation. Oh my gosh, it was just so good. So amazing to be able to just come apart. And the best part of it is that you can have that meditation anytime you want. It is available on our YouTube channel. Just go to youtube.com/upchurchla, find this service, and you can have your guided meditation any time of the day you like. It's yours. So thank you for that, Reverend Sheree. Thanks for getting it down for us so we can have it anytime. I'm Reverend Sheree. I am the assistant minister here at Up Church, and it is my joy and my honor to be here with you today. I want you to know that Up Church is a loving community, that we are so grateful that even though the church has left the building, we are still very much connected. We are still very much here to love each other up to our true potential. And so it's my honor to be able to welcome those of you who may be walking through our virtual doors for the very first time. And for those of you who may have come before, but you're just new to our ministry, I want to say welcome. And I want you to know that you are amongst some amazing people, some loving people, and they're getting ready to tell you who they are right now. And so right now in the chat, family, I want you to tell us who you are, give us your name, and then I want you to tell us the name, your real name, your spiritual name, your I am name. And I want you to call forth the I am in you that you need to hear. So I am Sheree, and I am courage. Tell us who you are. I want you to put that in the chat. Let people know who's worshiping together, who's in the congregation today. So I'm really excited because I know that somewhere in our congregation there is love. And I'm almost certain that somewhere in our congregation that there is joy. Come on, joy. Come on, let us know you're there. I know somewhere in our congregation there is peace. I want to hear you. I want to feel you, peace. So let us know right now. Tell us your name and then tell us your spiritual name. Put that in the chat. And so if you're visiting with us, you introduce yourself to us too. Tell us your name and tell us your spiritual name. We would love to get to know who is with us, who is worshiping with us, because we are, again, we're lovers here. And we really, really do have every intention. Every part of our service is about lifting you up. It's about raising your conscious awareness of your divinity. And so we trust that that's going to happen as you enjoy the rest of our service. I'm going to turn it over right now. I know you're still telling me who you are. Don't stop doing that. I want to make sure we get a feel of who's all in the congregation. But we're at that part in the service now where we get to hear some inspiration. And so I'm going to turn this over to Deidre, who's going to give us our daily inspiration for today. Take it, Deidre. I'm so excited to hear what our inspiration is today. I'm so excited.
And now your daily inspiration for April 26th, 2020. Serve others. Each one of us has a unique contribution to make to the world. It may be on a national or international scale, or it may be in your town, village, parish, province, or city. Whatever your achievements are or have been, they have been accomplished through the mighty power of God at work within you. You have been blessed and prospered in many ways. And now is a good time to share by giving of yourself, perhaps on a larger scale, in service to others. The world can always do with more love. There are many people, young and old, who could use a helping hand, your hand. You always have something to offer, your time, your expertise, your knowledge. Acts of kindness and words of encouragement are always welcome and meaningful. It does not matter how long you've been on the planet. There are many ways to serve. Only a life lived in service to others is worth living, Einstein said. Was he right? Serve one another humbly in love, Galatians 5:13.
Thank you so much, Deidre. We appreciate you. Deidre is on our marketing and promotions committee, and she also does a lot of our community outreach activities, our community-based. So when we go out to experience culture, our cultural arts committee, she is the spearheading that. And we're so grateful for your service. Serve others. That was the message for today. And thank you for giving us that inspiration. Now is the time that we get to speak the word for ourselves. We have our affirmation of power. And so we're working with this affirmation for the rest of April. And I want you to listen to me say it. I want you to open up your mind and hear me. And then we're going to speak it together. Okay? Here we go. I am God-centered, God-focused, and God-directed. I trust God as my source and my supply. I live, move, and have my being in God's never-ending supply of wisdom, intelligence, and lavish abundance. Yes, amen. Let's say that together. I am God-centered, God-focused, and God-directed. I trust God as my source and my supply. I live, move, and have my being in God's never-ending supply of wisdom, intelligence, and lavish abundance. And so it is, and so it is. Thank you. I want you to commit that affirmation to memory. I want you to work with it when you need to remind yourself of the truth. It is yours to speak aloud. And so if you commit it to memory, you can use it when one of those error thoughts pop up in your mind. So I want you to have that for yourself. We have another Sunday that we can practice it together, but let's get it committed to memory. I want you to know that we want to know how you're using the truth in your life. If you are using these affirmations, if you are using the something from the Sunday sermons, if you are blessed in any way by our ministry, we would love to hear your testimony. And so I want you to send your testimonies to upchurch@upchurch.org. That's our main email address. So just record yourself. It'd be cool if you can kind of do a recording, but if you want to write it out, please send that to our email address so that we can share that with the congregation, how you're using truth in your life. You're getting ready to hear one of the testimonies from one of our very, very, very dedicated members, John Downey III. He's going to share how he's been using the truth in his life and how the ministry has blessed him. So we're excited to hear from you, John.
Welcome to the house that God built. Hey, y'all, it's John Downey coming here. So the ministers tell me that this is testimony time, but Reverend Ella told me This is boasting time. This is a time where you get to talk about what God has done for you, or what I call glory to glory to glory. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Let me tell you something. A couple weeks ago, five to be exact, when I was sitting in my office in Hollywood and as scared as everybody else was, I had to sit there and I said, Father, I know you will protect me. Father, I know you will get me through this, whatever it is. I didn't have any food at the house, and I didn't know if I was going to have a job. The day before, 25% of the company had quit. The next day, 90% of the company got fired. And I sat there looking at the Hollywood sign with no kind of like contract that was going to keep me in place, but the contract that I have with the Father. And he said, 1,000 shall fall at thy side and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall come nigh thee. So I'm here to tell you, as I boast about God, what he has done for me. Anything I ask God, he gives me. And the real treasure that I learned in this time that I've had with God and me in our house together was the fact that a year ago, when I didn't have a job, I was fighting with God. I said, oh, Father, I don't want that job. Somebody had called me, and they had called from some resume I sent out in 2015. In fact, I met with them, and they didn't hire me, or I didn't hire them, or whatever it was, and I was like, I ain't interested in y'all. But guess what? God knew what was going to happen. And he said, my child, I want you to take this job. I'm like, Father, I don't know if I really, really, really want to do this. And so I decided that I would take the job. Well, that's the job that I'm sitting in right now. That is God's panoramic vision. You got to let God do for you what he's going to do through you. Amen. Hallelujah. Go tell that. Go tell it. Go tell it. All right, y'all. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Back up again.
mistake that we make sometimes. But the loving one, the living one, forgives us every time.
Get back up. Whoa.
A saint is just a sinner.
Oh my goodness. Thank you so much for that, Bobby. We fall down, but we get up. Isn't it amazing to know that you have that get back up again power? I mean, it's the perfect, he basically sang my sermon, but I'm still going to give it to you, but I just can't get enough of it. You have that get back up again power. See, sometimes we remember that we can fall down, but we forget that we have that get back up again power. That's the power I'm going to talk about today. The series title, what we're dealing with right now is an epidemic. It's a pandemic. It's a crisis. It's unprecedented times. Like, all of these terms make me cringe. And I'm so grateful for this series where we get to look at spiritual solutions for human crises. Spiritual solutions for human crises. So I'm just going to dive back in. This is week two of our sermon series, Spiritual Solutions for Human Crises. And today, I just wanted to give you guys this wake up call, right? To wake up, you're not on fire. I want you to get that. To wake up, you're not on fire. So let me get into the message. Every time I think about those things that make me cringe, those ways of describing this time in our life, right? The pandemic, the epidemic, whatever the word you want to put on it, I always think about the opportunity that's here. Like, what's unique? Here's another word. What's unique about this time is that everybody in the globe, for the most part, is experiencing something similar. Meaning that this coronavirus, the COVID-19 virus that everybody's talking about, it's kind of a conversation all over the world. And so it's interesting that we can all be thinking the same thing and having results that reflect the way that we're thinking about it. And so I want to just hone in on the opportunity we have here to recognize what a collective consciousness can look like, that we're all thinking and kind of maybe feeling some of the same things. And so I want us to get that we can raise that energy up. So that just how we're all tapped into maybe a lower level vibration, that we as a community, everybody who can hear my voice, we can raise that energy up, because that's what happened. That there was one person screaming about something, there was some part, and it just kind of spread, right? And so we can begin to raise the truth in that same manner. So I just see this as an opportunity. What an amazing time it is. And though this thing is happening to everybody, we're not all having the same experience. I mean, I want you to think about it. There are people probably in your home that aren't having the same experience that you're having. And so think about that as we move through this lesson, that you're having a unique experience. And so why is it that one person can be completely at peace and one person totally unsettled? Why is it that someone can be finding an opportunity in this moment and other people are just having everything they feel stripped away from them? So we are having a unique experience. And I really believe that these spiritual solutions for human crises, that when you really hone in on what we're talking about, you're going to hear why, and then you're going to be able to see how to change your experience. So I was reading through this magazine and something popped out at me. I'm not a Val Kilmer fan. I don't know if you know this actor. I remember him from Batman, but I know he's been in a ton of other things. But in the 90s, he was the guy. And there's an article about him, and the picture stood out to me because he just looks so different as he's aged. But I didn't know that Val Kilmer was a Christian Scientist. And so his philosophy of, meaning he grew up in Christian Science. His philosophy was very much, I'm hearing and listening, reading this interview, and I'm hearing new thought all through it. But I pulled this quote out to share with you guys. Sometimes you have to be aggressive about finding a way to be courageous, he said, and not believing what your physical picture may be demanding you accept as real. Like if someone came into the room and they were sleepwalking and they were screaming that their feathers were on fire, what would you do? And so in the interview, the journalist was getting ready to say something back, and he said, you have to find a way to wake them up. He said, because they don't have feathers, and so they're not on fire. That's Val Kilmer. And that article shook me, and I'm gonna work with it a little bit today, because many of us are walking around with our feathers on fire. And so as my spiritual responsibility to you is to say, wake up, your feathers are not on fire. You are not on fire. And I'm gonna give you the method to put the fire out in your own mind. So I don't wanna waste this crisis. I don't wanna waste this pandemic, epidemic, whatever name you wanna give it. I want it to be our wake up call to a higher state of consciousness. Because there's really just one truth and one lie. I know we have a lot of different ways of saying it, but there's just one truth and there's one lie. The truth is that you are one with God. The lie is that you're separated from God. One truth and one lie. The truth is that you are one with God, and the lie is that you believe you are separate from God. So once we can get to that truth and dispel that lie, it really balances out everything else in our lives. And so I'm going to work with this as we move forward, because the story that I want to kind of work with from scripture today is taken from 1 Kings chapter 18. Why I love this story that I'm going to tell you today from 1 Kings chapter 18 is really because I believe that Elijah tells us what to do with a human crisis. And so he was in the midst of a human crisis, meaning that there's a lot of things happening with him. But the one I want to hone in on is that he was working with King Ahab. He had predicted that there was going to be a drought, and there was. And then he predicts that there's going to be rain. And he's beginning to be a little, people are doubting his ability to be a prophet, right? And so in this story, 1 Kings started at chapter 18, just go and read it, some good stuff in there. But I want to get down into the scripture where he basically has to go and see the rain where there appeared to be no clouds in the sky. And so I'm going to work with that today, because it's a story that really outpictures the reality that you are the thinker that thinks the thought that create the things. I'm going to say that again. This is from Reverend Johnny Coleman taught me this. You are the thinker that think the thoughts that create the things. Many of us have grown up to believe that we are the thoughts we think. And so we define ourselves by the things moving around in our mind. But in reality, you're the thinker. Because let me give you a little experiment of that. You can really just sit right now and think about what you're thinking about. So who's doing the thinking? If you can think about what you're thinking about, who's doing the thinking? You are not the thoughts that you think. And so I want to get into how this works. We're going to get into some mind mechanics, if you don't mind. In the book, Hidden Power for Human Problems, that's the text we're working with. In this text, he really goes into this concept that you got to get as we move through the series, this concept of parent thoughts. And so I want to give you the definition of what a parent thought is. A parent thought is a deep-seated lie that you believe to be true. Now, I know those of you who were a part of Break Every Chain have heard this before, right? I told you there's just one truth and one lie. We're just giving you a lot of different ways to work with it. But there is a parent thought, as we work with it in this series, is a deep-seated lie. It's a belief that you're operating out of. And it is this thought that has offspring, right? So this belief that you have that thoughts spring off from. And what we're going to do today is deal with the parent thought. That's really what the whole intention is. Because when you have a parent thought like irritation, and this irritation is essentially having offspring that you are irritable all the time, that you have chaos and confusion in your relationships. This is what happens when that parent thought is unchecked and just continues to produce thoughts that create experiences that you don't want to live in. And so many times we have these experiences, we leave a situation and we're like, well, wait a minute, I'm back in that same mess. And that's because you didn't get to the parent thought. You were dealing with the children. And so you can get away, you can shoo away, you can get rid of as many of the children as you want. But until you deal with that parent thought, nothing will last. No change will last. And so how I like to think about this, I'm giving you parent thought, giving you some mind mechanics. The parent thought is that belief, that lie. Remember I told you there's just a truth and a lie. That separation from God. So there is a lie that you believe that separates you in consciousness from the one power and one presence. The children, the offspring of that lie, of that parent thought, are the chaos and confusion you then began to create in your life. You are the thinker that think the thoughts that create the things. Now, you as thinker are responsible for what you believe. And so what we're doing here is we're giving you a foundation in truth principles so that you can be a thinker that's thinking true thoughts that create things you want to experience and express in your life. And so we're trying to give you the mind mechanics behind this in this series, because some of the children of a thought, like a parent thought like irritation, like some of the children of that thought manifest as impatience, manifest as chaotic relationships, as business deals that don't go through, as a body that can manifest chronic decisions, like erosive things in your body. All of this happens as a result of a parent thought of irritation that I am not getting my way. And so there is a part of you that needs to grow up, and it's been arrested in development. And so what we're trying to do is wake up that part of you, to grow that part of you up, that believes yourself to be separate from good, that believes that you have to have an all-out tantrum in order to have the life experience that you want to have. And so the way that the parent thought works, all of that, my mechanics, we're coming around to how does the parent thought work? Because if we can understand the mechanics of a thing, we can make some adjustments. And so the mind mechanics behind this, how a parent thought works, is that your thoughts create in their image likeness. I want you to hear that. Your thoughts are creative. So you are made in the image likeness of God. Your experiences are made in the image likenesses of what you believe and what you think. And so when you are looking at your life, world, and affairs, you're looking at the offspring of your beliefs and your thinking. And so what we want to do is get that the reason that my body, my life, my world, and affairs may not be reflecting my true divine nature, it's because I have a belief and I'm working with that lie, right? I believe in that lie. I believe in my separation from the one power and one presence. Every thought that you think is going to have to present itself somewhere. Every thought you think is going to have to present itself somewhere. I can't wait. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I can't wait to get back to Elijah, but I want you to think about that. 1 Kings chapter 18. I want you to bookmark that. Go and read that scripture thoroughly, and I'm going to come down to the end of it and work with it. So how did the parent thought work? I'm going to give you another illustration. You ever been dating somebody and they're not treating you right? And so you break up with them and you start dating somebody else, and this person is cool, and then they stop treating you right. And so you're like, you know what? I'm moving to New York. All the people in New York are cool people. That's where my love is. I'm moving to New York. And you go to New York and you meet somebody. Somebody pair you with this person. They're like, you are going to fall in love with this person. They are perfect for you. And you get with them and they are. It's amazing. It's amazing. And then they stop treating you right. And so here you are. You've moved from person to person. You've moved from where you live to someplace else, all looking for a different experience. When there's a book, I wish I could think of the author's name, but it's a book that's called Wherever You Go, There You Are. And so all you did was take your parent thought of unworthiness from relationship to relationship, from land to land, and you essentially produce the same result. That's how your parent thought works, that you cannot escape that parent thought. And so we got to deal with it. Now, we spent time during the Lenten experience dealing with our deep, deep stuff. And so we're not done with that. We're still excavating. We're still getting down to the root of things, because we are good through and through, and it's time for us to live that way. And so I'm saying that collectively, like, okay, let me say, am I saying that any human crisis that we're dealing with, that it came because of our collective thinking? So did we think a virus? Did we think war? Did we think that kind? Did we think this stuff into being? Is that what I'm saying? I want you to hear me, because I know a lot of times this comes up when you hear New Thought teachers talk about you being your own experience, talking about the power of your thinking. But I want to tell you that the mind doesn't quite work as linear as we think it works. It's not like, oh, I think of this bad thing and then this bad thing happens to me. That's not always how it works. It's a complex machine that we're working with, this mind machine. And so what we get is that sometimes you don't know until you do the soul work whether you're dealing with the children or the parent. And so what we want to do is get to that deep-seated belief. And so in this series, we're really going to knock out what the author calls the six core ones. So I'm saying that you do not have to succumb to the thoughts that you've been thinking. I know it may sound like I'm talking out both sides of my neck. You don't have to succumb to the thoughts that you're thinking, because you got to realize that you're the thinker. When you realize that you're the thinker, it changes the very nature, the vibration, and the purpose of the thoughts that you think. This is what I mean by that. I said that you have parent thoughts. These are those deep-seated lies that you believe in and that you begin to think from, and you begin to create offspring that are reflective of that lie. You also have what's called master thoughts. And your master thoughts are your God thoughts. They're the thoughts that come from the knowingness that you are made in the image likeness of God. They're the thoughts of the thoughts that are moving in the mind of God. So these are thoughts of love and power. These are thoughts of life. These are thoughts of wealth and vitality. And so these are the master thoughts that we want to be moving around in our minds. These are constructive thoughts. And if you begin to develop spiritual mastery, you begin to have power and control over the parent thoughts. You begin to disempower them because you know what the truth is. Remember, I told you there's just two things. There's the lie and the truth. That there's just really two, the lie and the truth. There's one truth and there's one lie. So you have to practice spiritual mastery just like you practice being irritable. You didn't just come up cranky. You practice being cranky. You let the experiences that you've been going through, you've let your whole world has conformed itself behind you being irritated about something, behind you not having a maturity to be able to be in a situation when things aren't going your way, not to have a tantrum about it. Now, I know I'm not talking to everybody. I know all of us are not dealing with low levels of emotional maturity, but I'm gonna tell you that I have had some tantrums. I can preach to myself first, that I've had some emotional tantrums because I didn't get what I wanted. And it's not cute. My emotional tantrums are not cute. And they basically continue to affirm a lie of me being separated from my good. And if I feel like I'm separated from my good and I don't know how to get it, and I have this emotional reaction, is it that I think that I can connive my way into getting what I want? I'm just talking about me. But when I remember who I am, when I remember that I'm a spiritual master and that I have mastery, dominion, and authority and control over my thoughts and feelings, I am the thinker. I'm not the thoughts that I think. When I remember that, I get that, oh, wait a minute, I am not a human being. I'm a spiritual being with spiritual mastery. Now, human beings work on fight or flight. Outside stimulus come and they begin to interact with it. So you fight it or you flight, and that's what those tantrums are. But as a spiritual master, you get that you don't fight, you don't flight, you transcend the challenge, you transcend the crisis. You have to realize that there's just one truth and one lie, and that the truth is what you're telling yourself about yourself. You no longer engage and play around with the lie. You completely focus on the truth. You're a spiritual master. And I want you to stand up and be who you really are, because in the midst of all the challenges that have been happening in this world, the truth has not changed one bit. The truth has not changed. God is still all there is. That there is just one power and one presence that is active. That you, spiritual being, are made in the image likeness of God. That has not changed. There's no situation in the universe that can come and separate you from who you really are. And so you have to know that just because you're made in the image likeness of God, that you also push out of you all the love, power, that healing power that you've been calling forth, that's right within you. Call it from you and stop trying to get it to rain down upon you. You are made in the image likeness of God. The truth about you has not changed. There is no outside situation that could possibly get in the way of who you are and what you're designed to be and what you're designed to do and what you're designed to have. You're a spiritual master. You transcend. So what's the spiritual solution to this human crisis? Is transcend it, spiritual being. Stop thinking thoughts about it. Remember the one truth and let go of the lie. You see, this is how Elijah did it when he went on top of Mount Carmel, because he told King Ahab it was going to rain. And for what I know about King Ahab, he was a little nuts. So he's waiting on the result to come through. Elijah goes to Mount Carmel. When you see anybody in scripture go to a higher place, like a higher geographical place, you know that metaphysically we're talking about a raising of consciousness. Okay, so he goes to Mount Carmel and he takes his servant with him. And he goes and he puts his hand between his knees and he tells his servant to look out into that blue sky and find that rain for me. And the servant comes back like, all right, Elijah, there is no, this sky is blue as all get out. There is no clouds in the sky. And Elijah says, go back. He goes back, comes back with the same report. Go back. He does this seven times. And the servant comes back finally and says, okay, all right, way, way, way off in the distance, I see a cloud, but it's like the size of a man's hand. It's a nothing cloud. And Elijah says, go tell King Ahab to hurry up home because the rain is going to catch him. You see, the thinking process, I want to get down into this part of the story with Elijah, because you got to get in control of your reactions. You see, your servant is your intellect, and your intellect is out here looking at CNN, looking at MSNBC, reading the CDC reports, and your intellect is coming back with these reports about how things are trying to attack you, right? And so what you got to remember is, my head is not supposed to be on that. My attention is supposed to be focused on the reality of my being. I put my head between my knees. I stop looking at appearances. I stop letting the appearances define me. I stop letting the lie be empowered. I am one with God. I am one with all life. And so there is no way I'm impenetrable to any force that's trying to come and attack me. I am impenetrable. I'm invincible about this thing. And so what I want you to do is get your attention off the appearance. You see, we're following Elijah's model. Get your attention off of the appearance and see good. See health. Insist that that everything, every thought is servant to what you see, to what you know is true. And so this is what Ahab did. When the report kept coming back that there was none, when the report kept coming back that there was no rain, when the report kept coming back that there was lack and limitation, he told his servant to go back. You're going to go back until you get in alignment with the truth that I know. You see, I will no longer combine with the lie. So I'm going to give you this. What am I telling you to do? What am I telling you to do? I'm giving you some spiritual solutions for the human crisis. First, you got to find God in it. The first thing you got to do is find God in it. So the author uses like a tranquil scene. He uses a sunset and says, okay, now if you can contemplate a sunset, does that sunset ever change? Does the sun start setting quicker because there's a lot going on today? Well, the sun is made in the image likeness of God. The sun is a spirit, the essence of spirit, right? And so are you. So you have the qualities of divine order, peace, and tranquility, the same way the sun does, the same way the sun sets. And so he would say, you got to find the good in it. So no matter what is circling around you, find God in it. Somewhere in it, there is the essence of God. And it's just waiting for you to see it, recognize it, so you can call it forth into your experience. So first, I want to tell you, Reverend Sherri said, understand how the creative law works. And the way that I'm phrasing that for you this week is to find the God in whatever circumstance you're going through. Find the God in feast, find the God in famine, find the God in disease, find the God in anything you're going through. And the second thing you want to do is identify with the God in it. She said, form the correct mental image. That was the way that it was phrased last week. Same principle, same practice. Find the God in it and then identify with the God in it. You see, sometimes we want God to be way over there. And if we think, if I just beg right, if I just plead real good, if I say the right prayer, that God will come and give me what I ask for. And we got to disabuse ourselves of that. We got to let that thought go, because the reality is that you are as close to God as your breath, and that any request, any desire on your heart has already been fulfilled in spirit. And so all you have to do is open up and recognize that you are one with it. You got to identify with the God that you see. And so, you know, a sweet little way to do this is to recognize, you know, if I look at all this grass in my lawn, and I think about, this is just my lawn, not all the lawns that there exist in the world, not all of the fields that exist in the world, not all of the places that there are blades of grass. I can't even count the little patch in my yard. That's the abundance of God right there manifest in front of me. And then I identify with it. I say, I am one with that lavish abundance. And so I have found the God in it. I have recognized that I am one with it. And then I began, Reverend Sherri gave it to us this way, to release your image to God, right? So this idea, whatever it is I'm working with, I release it. I speak the word of truth about it. Even if you don't believe, this is the truth about me, whether I believe it or not. You see, you got to be like the father that brought his son to Jesus and asked for him to be healed. This is in Mark chapter 9. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. So this father comes bringing his son to him and said, here's the way your son is healed. If you believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And so my brother says, he immediately cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And so I want you to get that today. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. You see, when Elijah put his head between his knees, he could have got caught up in unbelief that, oh my goodness, it's not going to rain. There's no clouds in the sky. They won't believe me anymore. But he said, no. He told his servant to go back. So you got to keep telling your servant to go back. Help my unbelief. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Heal my unbelief. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Lord, I believe my faith is greater than what I believed before. My faith is greater than what I believed before. I believe, God, heal my unbelief. You see, there's a power in you to just call it forth, just to declare that you know what you know, that I know that the healing is available to me, and I get to experience the fruit of that because I've killed the parent thought of separation. I killed the parent thought of irritation, and I get to be free to have peace. I get to be free to have harmony in my relationships because I've let go of what was causing it. So no longer can I have that spring off into my experience. I began to work with my master thinking that I'm made in the image likeness of God. I'm good through and through, and I'm meant to burst good into expression. That's what I'm here for. I transcend my unbelief. You see, I don't fight. I don't flight. I transcend my unbelief because I know the truth about myself regardless of appearances. And so I'm here to tell you spiritual beings. I'm here to tell you spiritual masters to wake up. I want you to wake up and become your real self. I want you to wake up and become whole. I want you to wake up and become courageous. I want you to wake up and become invincible. You see, you have to wake up. You don't have feathers. You are not on fire. You're here to see the truth in the midst of whatever is going on in front of you, whatever is going on around you, whatever is going on inside your body. You're here to hold the truth. Wake up and be who you really are. You're not on fire. You are not on fire. This is not an emergency. You are a spiritual being in divine action. You are a spiritual being on divine assignment. Stand up, become who you really are. God bless you today. Have a beautiful day today. And I want you to really just enjoy the message, the becoming song that's coming your way. This was written by Noriko and Jade, and you're just going to love it. It is absolutely the way that I want you to think about. What I want you to think about as you move away from this message, as you allow it to sit in your heart, as you call the Holy Spirit to come and move upon the words and give you the revelation, to give you the insight, to give you the spiritual direction that you need to go into. There is a message in here for you. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Go to the Father and go and get your blessing out of it. God bless you today. I love you today. And I'm so grateful to have you as being a part of our community. God bless you.
Musicians on the planet. I tell you. I say this every Sunday. And you know it's true. We're so blessed. Thank you so much, worship team. All right, family. This is our opportunity to bring the tithes into the storehouse. We believe in the dignity of an equal energy exchange. And so this is our opportunity to give back to the place that has sown into us. If you are participating in our building fund, I'd like to let you know that it is week 17. And so that means that the gift is $17 or any multiple of 17. We have a number of ways for you to share with Understanding Principles, both electronic and regular mail. Electronically, you can make contributions to via Cash App. Our Cash App ID is $UpChurchLA. $UpChurchLA. And two things I will ask with the Cash App. Please put your name, if your Cash App name is not your actual name, so that we can send a giving statement properly, because we cannot send a giving statement to Tutti Frutti Old Rudy. We can't send a gift statement to him. So please put your name in there, and then also what the gift is for if you want it directed to a specific fund. You can also give via text to give. And what you'll do is bring up a text message screen the way you would send a text message to a friend. And in the 2 section, what you'll do is you'll type a 5-digit number, 7322. 256. And in the message section where you would normally type your message, you would put the word UPCHURCH, all one word, no spaces. And when you do that and hit send, it's gonna give you back a reply. In that reply will be a link. When you click that link, it will take you to a safe page where you're able to complete your gift. I also want to let you know that you can go to our website at upchurch.org. There is a gold button there that says Give Online. And that, if you click that button, it will also take you to a safe page where you can complete your gift. And you can still use the good old-fashioned postal service. So you can mail your gifts to 600 West Queen Street, Inglewood, California, 90301. Okay. Two things we want to do. One, we're going to bless it, and then we're going to make a declaration about it. So first, let's bless. However you've come prepared to share, you want to take it in your left hand, cover it in your right hand, and repeat after me. Divine love blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, all that I receive. I give in love. And I trust God. Yes, thank you, God. And now we're going to complete that blessing with a declaration. In the chat, this is what I want you to do. However you have given, say, I am in the flow. I am in the flow. I give cheerfully. I receive graciously. I am divinely supplied. God is my all sufficiency. Now, you don't have to say all of that. Just pick the one that resonates with you. But what you are doing is that you are backing up the blessing with a declaration that it is so, that my giving returns to me what I have sent it forward to do. And so I give cheerfully and I receive graciously. And I think I heard, I saw Reverend Sheree last week. She said, I give massively and I receive lavishly. I said, that's good, I'm gonna take that. I give massively and I receive lavishly. Thank you, family. Thank you so much for your support of this ministry. I am going to pass it over to our assistant minister, Reverend Sheree Thompson, for some announcements. And then I'll be back to close us out.
Before we get to those announcements, Reverend Sherri, it's time to celebrate our birthdays in April. Cam, would you please serenade them?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday.
It's time for our announcements. We have a very special announcement coming to you from Noriko and Jade, and then we'll tell you what else is up at UP.
With the release of the song Becoming, Jade and I decided to do Becoming Challenge. I'm gonna have Jade explain what this challenge is all about. Jade, take it away.
Hey guys, so like you heard Noriko say, we decided to do this Becoming Challenge in honor of the release of the song Becoming, and we wanted to hear from you guys. We want to know what exactly the word Becoming means to you. So for example, in my opinion, the word Becoming means ever-changing, ever-evolving, And, you know, I felt like I was in a season when we started writing the song that I was in a space of unbecoming in order to become. I had to unbecome the person that thought negative before positive. I had to unbecome the person that thought about what others thought about me instead of what I think about me. And I had to unbecome the person that stayed so stagnant that I let laziness and procrastination take over my life rather than drive and determination. So I felt like I had to overcome all these things in order to become who God had placed inside of me all along. So I'm excited to hear from you guys what the word becoming means to you.
That's what's up at up. Back to you, Reverend Sherri, for our benediction.
Thank you, Reverend Sheree, for those announcements. And thank you, family, for being here. How you feel? You feel good? You feel good? I'm trusting that you received what you needed. If nothing else, because you're still here and we at the end of the hour together. But I just bless you this week to be all that God has called you to be. I bless you to be victorious in the face of any obstacle. I bless you to be strong. I bless you to be powerful. I bless you to believe in yourself. I bless you to change your thoughts so that you may change your life. I bless you to receive all the good that God has for you. And I give thanks for you. Let us take our closing prayer. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. And the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and so it is. Have a beautiful week. I can't wait to see you here next week. God bless you. Okay.